I'm Pastor Jeff Shreve, and this is From His Heart. Hey, thanks for being with us today. We're in a series on the Holy Spirit called The Unknown God. We're discovering the person and power of the Holy Spirit. Now, lots of us have heard about this thing called being filled with the Holy Spirit. But what does that really mean? How does that really happen? And what does it look like when a person is filled with the Spirit? Grab your Bible and turn to Ephesians chapter 5 as we ask this important question. Are you filled or are you foolish? If you have your Bibles, please turn to Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, I want to speak to you on this subject, filled or foolish. Philip Yancey, the great Christian author, he wrote a foreword for a book called Life in the Spirit. And in his foreword, he tells a story about a Japanese man who came to know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. And they were teaching this man about Christian doctrine. They were teaching him about the Holy Trinity. And his response was so honest. He said this, "Honorable Father, very good. Honorable Son, very good. Honorable Bird, do not understand at all." Speaking of the Holy Spirit, the heavenly dove, he called that the honorable bird. He couldn't grasp the Holy Spirit. He speaks for lots of people who don't really understand the ministry, the work, the person, the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's why we're in this series called The Unknown God, discovering the person and the power of the Holy Spirit. You remember Jesus told the disciples, he said, "It is to your advantage that I go away, because when I go away, I'm going to send another helper, another just like me. And he'll not only be with you, but he'll live in you." Adrian Rogers defines the Holy Spirit this way. He is Christ in the Christian. Christ in the Christian. You remember I told you last week, if you want to think about God, God is three persons, one God. God the Father is God without skin. God the Son is God with skin. God the Holy Spirit is God who comes to live in our skin. And that is the Trinity. The three are one. And today we want to talk about the subject of being filled with the Spirit. Filled or foolish. Did you know, the Bible makes this very clear, every Christian has the Holy Spirit living inside. Every Christian has the Holy Spirit resident, but not every Christian has the Holy Spirit president. Every Christian has the Holy Spirit residing in their lives, but not every Christian has the Holy Spirit presiding in his or her life. It's the difference between being filled or being foolish. Now, sad reality. A.W. Tozer said this so many years ago. He said, in the average church, the average congregation, so much of what takes place doesn't require the power of the Holy Spirit. He went on to say this, if the Holy Spirit were removed from the church, 95% of what we do would still go on and no one would know the difference. What a sad commentary. He went on to say this, in the New Testament church that we read about in Scripture, he said if the Holy Spirit had been removed from the New Testament church, 95% of what they did would stop immediately and everyone would notice. They depended upon the Holy Spirit, and we tend so often to not depend upon Him because we don't know, because we don't understand, because we are just so complacent so much of the time in our Christianity. So today, we want to really dive into the subject of being filled with the Spirit. And as we do, I want everyone to look within. Let's do this little little activity. Take your hands and do like this. Everybody do like this. Make a little circle. The person I want you to work on today is the person in that circle. Okay? Nobody move it over to your spouse. Okay, let's just work on the person in the circle. Okay? That is you and that is me. Ephesians chapter 5. Begin reading in verse 15. The Apostle Paul says this. He's writing from prison. This is one of the four prison epistles, Philippians and Colossians and Philemon and Ephesians, all written from his first Roman imprisonment. He says in verse 15, "Therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of your time, of your opportunity, because the days are evil. So then, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. Do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is, and do not be drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit." I want us to notice three discoveries today from this passage of Scripture, this great passage of Scripture. Discovery number one. As it relates to being filled or foolish, let's talk about foolish. The foolish can be placed into two categories. Foolish are into two categories. Now, when the Scripture says, do not be foolish, the word for foolish can also be translated mindless, ignorant, stupid, rash, unbelieving, senseless, egotistic. Don't be like that. Don't be mindless. Don't be foolish in how you respond to the Lord. Understand what the will of the Lord is. Now, the foolish can be placed into two categories, two kinds of foolish people. And no doubt in this congregation, no doubt people watching live streaming, watching on television, listening on radio, people are in two categories if you are in the foolish group. Fools can be put into two categories. First of all, there's the complete fool, and then there's the Christian fool. So let's talk about the complete fool first. The complete fool is the person who rejects and ignores the salvation found only in Jesus Christ. We would call that person a complete and utter fool because it's so foolish and senseless and stupid to reject the Lord Jesus Christ, the God who loves you, the God who died for you, who bled for you on the cross, who rose again from the dead. To reject him makes absolutely no sense at all. It's a foolish thing to do. And the Scripture bears that out because Jesus told a parable about the wise builder and the foolish builder. Remember, we sing that little song, "The wise man built his house upon the rock. The foolish man built his house upon the sand." And Jesus said, everyone who hears these words of mine and acts upon him, he's a wise builder who built his house upon a rock, and the rains descended and the floods came and the winds blew and burst against his house, but it did not fall because it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act upon them, he is a foolish builder. He is the man who built his house on the sand. And the rains descended and the floods came and the winds blew and burst against that house and it fell, and great was its fall. Foolish because he heard, but he didn't respond. He didn't build on what the Lord said. He didn't do what the Lord said to do. Jesus told another parable about a rich man who had so much come in that his barns couldn't hold it all. And he said, what am I going to do? I have more grain than I know what to do with. I know what I'll do. I'll build bigger barns. And then I will have everything set up and I'll have all my grain set up in my bigger barns. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. And the Lord said to him, you fool, for tonight your soul is required of you. So is the man, Jesus said, who is rich in this world and is not rich toward God, a fool. So the utter fool is the person who rejects Christ or just ignores Christ. You know, sometimes we get the idea that, well, you know, I'm not a rejecter. I'm not shaking my fist in the face of God. Well, you don't have to do that. You just have to kind of blow him off. You just kind of have to ignore him. You like the Doobie Brothers. You just tip your hat to him and say, well, Jesus is just all right with me, but I'm not very interested in following you. I mean, you're okay, but I'm going to go this way. You're a fool if you do that, because that way always ends up in destruction and ultimately in hell. So that's the first category, is complete fools. Second category of fools is what we'll call the Christian fool. The Christian fool is a person who rejects or ignores the filling of the Holy Spirit. The filling of the Holy Spirit. This is the person who has received Christ, but he's not letting Christ lead him by his Spirit. Let me put it to you this way. Here's a picture of the complete fool. It's a diagram that shows what this person's life is like. The complete fool, Christ is outside the life, self is on the throne of life, and those circles are interests that are directed by self. They result in discord and frustration. This person's never received Christ. They're a complete fool. This is the Christian fool. He has received Christ, he or she, but Christ isn't calling the shots. Self is still on the throne. This isn't a self-centered life, but it's a self-directed life. And the interests are directed by self, and there is frustration there, and there's futility there, and there's discord there, and Christ is dethroned and not allowed to direct this person's life. Now, lots of Christians live like that. A Christian fool. They're not being led by the Holy Spirit, trying to live the Christian life in the power of self. That will never work. I like what one preacher said, the Christian life is not hard, it's impossible. No one can live it other than Jesus by his Spirit. And he wants to live it through you. Now, we all remember when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, the night he was betrayed, he was praying. And he wanted his disciples to pray with him. He said, remain here with me, watch and pray. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. And he went away from them about a stone's throw, and he fell down on his face, and he began to pray so earnestly. And there was so much pressure on him that the capillaries in his face broke, and he began to sweat drops of blood. And his prayer three times, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, not my will, but thine be done. That was his prayer. Not my will, but thine be done. Now, the Christian fool is the one who doesn't mouth these words, but lives these words. Not thy will, but mine be done. But mine be done. And I'm going to sit on the throne of my life, and I'm going to do what I want to do. And yes, Jesus, I believe in you. And yes, Jesus, I've trusted you as Savior and as Lord, but I don't want you to be Lord right now because I want to direct my own life. That's the foolish person. And the Christian fool describes so many people in the church. So that's the first discovery. The foolish can be placed into two categories. Discovery number two, the filled understand the will of the Lord. So then, verse 17, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. What is the will of the Lord? Well, the will of the Lord is that you not be a complete fool. He wants you to be saved. He wants you to know him. He wants you to have him in your life. He wants to live inside of you. That's the will of the Lord. He's not willing, the scripture says, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, he's not willing, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. This is good and acceptable, the Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 2. This is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. What is the will of the Lord? That you sitting here today, that you watching today, that you listening today would come to know Jesus Christ and be saved. That's the will of the Lord. But also the will of the Lord is not only that you'd be saved, but that you would be Spirit-filled. Spirit-filled. So don't be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Verse 18, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation. That is a waste. That is going to result in your ruin. But be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. Now, what does that mean, to be filled with the Spirit? The will of God is that you be filled. God wants you to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. To be filled with the Spirit means that you are controlled by the Holy Spirit. And the way you know that that's what he is referring to is because he uses a contrast with getting drunk. Do not get drunk with wine, where is an excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Don't get drunk with wine, it's a contrast. Well, I'm not supposed to do this, but I am supposed to do that. Well, why the contrast with getting drunk with wine? Well, for a couple of reasons. Number one, it's because in the pagan worship, they would often get drunk because they said that that connected them to their pagan gods. And so they would drink and drink and drink. And they said the more drunk you were, the more you would commune with your gods. You know, some of the places in that you can go to in Israel, we went to Beth Shan in Israel, and there are a lot of the ruins there from this city. And in their theater, their auditorium there, they had a special place called the vomitorium, where you would drink and eat and drink and eat and drink and eat until you couldn't have any more. And then you go to the vomitorium to vomit so you could drink and eat some more. Pretty gross, isn't it? But they would get drunk with wine because that, they said, well, that's going to get us closer to our gods. Do not get drunk with wine, Paul is saying. That's not going to get you close to God. And the scripture says in Proverbs chapter 20, verse 1, wine is a mocker and strong drink a brawler, and whoever is intoxicated by it is not wise. What does the Bible say here? Therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise. So don't get drunk with wine. He uses that as a contrast. Don't do that. But then he also uses it as a comparison, because we all know that when a person gets drunk with whatever alcohol, wine, beer, hard liquor, whatever it is, when you're drunk, it changes you, changes the way you act, changes the way you react, changes what you say. You lose needed inhibitions when you get drunk. Now, I have had the shameful experience in my life of being drunk on many occasions when I was a high school student, not even old enough to drink, but I was getting drunk, wasn't a Christian, and that's just what we did. We would go out on weekends and we would get drunk. And man, I did some stupid things. And it's by the grace of God that I'm still alive, based on some of the things I did, getting behind a wheel, inebriated, and passing people on a curve and things like that. I still relive some of those things and just shudder and just say, God, you're so good to me that I didn't die. And the things that I said to people and the trouble that I got into, that's a horrible thing. Some people think it's cute to be drunk. It's not. Have you ever been sober and you've been around drunks? When I started to get my life right with God and started to walk with God, then I would go out with my buddies on the weekends, but I wouldn't drink. And I would be the designated driver, and I'd be there, and they'd be getting drunk. And I'd think to myself, surely I wasn't that much of an idiot, was I? And the answer was, yes, you were. You know, they're just acting like idiots. I heard of one man, he was talking to another man, and they were talking about alcohol, and he said to his friend, he said, well, you know, I drink vodka. He said, oh yeah, why do you drink vodka? He said, well, if you drink vodka, people can't smell it on your breath. They don't know that you've been drinking. His friend said, well, if I were you, I'd drink something else. It'd be better for them to know you're drinking than to think you're stupid. Don't get drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. So there's a contrast, don't do this, but there's also a comparison, because when you are filled with the Spirit, it's like being drunk with wine in that you are controlled by the Holy Spirit. See, the natural thing for us to think is filled with the Spirit. It's like a glass, and the Spirit is being poured into you. And we want to go all the way to the top with the Holy Spirit. And the word means that. But here's the problem with thinking along those lines. The Holy Spirit is not a substance. The Holy Spirit is a person. So when you're filled with a person, it's not like he's water and he's coming in, oh, I have a lot of the Holy Spirit today, oh, I don't have very much of the Holy Spirit today, and he's coming like that. No. See, some people teach that when you get saved, you don't really get the Holy Spirit. You just get just kind of like initiated, and but then you have to seek and pray and long for and desire to be quote unquote baptized in the Holy Spirit. And some people get that and some people don't. And when you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, I was reading one book and they said, well, you know, a Christian is kind of like in a mist. If you think of the Holy Spirit like water, he's in a mist and he's getting a little bit wet, but not very much. But a Christian who's baptized in the Holy Spirit, that's a person who's in the downpour and they're getting all of this from the Holy Spirit. And so then you have the Christian have-nots in the mist and the Christian haves, and they've had this experience and they say, well, you haven't had this experience and so you need to seek this experience. They call it the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you, according to Scripture, there is one baptism by Jesus into his Spirit, and that happens the moment that you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. He's the baptizer, the Lord Jesus Christ, and John said, I baptize you in water, but another is coming after me, the thong of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He shall baptize you in the Holy Spirit. And Jesus puts us in the Holy Spirit the moment we put our faith and trust in him. Nowhere in the Bible are we ever commanded to seek the indwelling of the Spirit, to seek the baptism with the Spirit, to seek anything like that. Scripture doesn't command us to do that. It commands us to be filled with the Spirit. And this is a command, to be filled with the Holy Spirit. So sometimes you can get into semantics, and some people that say, well, you know, when you're in the downpour, well, what does that mean? Does that mean you've gotten a second blessing? It means you're filled with God's Spirit. It means that the Lord is in control. This is the Christ-directed life. This is a person who's received Christ, and Christ is on the throne. Christ by his Spirit. Remember we said, well, there's the Holy Spirit. There's a way to think of the Holy Spirit. He's Christ in the Christian. Because he's another, Jesus said, just like me. So Christ in the Christian, Christ is on the throne, and Christ is calling the shots, and self is yielded to Jesus Christ. That's being filled with God's Spirit, being controlled with God's Spirit. He wants you to be controlled. That's, understand what the will of the Lord is. That's how he wants you to live the Christian life, with Christ on the throne, with self off the throne, and with the Lord giving you power to live. Now, not only does God want you to live controlled by the Spirit, but God wants you to live continually yielded to the Holy Spirit. Here's the trouble we get into. We think that this Spirit-filled life is just a one-time zap. And because maybe we've been taught that, and maybe say you're struggling in your Christian life and somebody tell you, well, you know, you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, because if you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, wham, it's just a zap. And then all of a sudden you're out of the mist and you're into the downpour and everything has changed. And then that's all you need. That changes everything for all time. That's not true. That's not true. The scripture says in verse 18, in the Greek language, the way it's constructed, be being filled with the Holy Spirit. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be being filled with the Spirit. It's a continual, ongoing thing where the Lord says, hey, moment by moment, let me control you by my Spirit. Be being filled. It's not that you do it once and you're done. We know that for sure, because in the book of Acts, it talks about, and they were filled with the Spirit, and then again, and they were filled with the Spirit, and then again, they were filled with the Spirit. Why do you guys have to keep being filled with the Spirit? Well, because it's a continual moment by moment thing. See, it never says, and be baptized in the Spirit. Be baptized with the Spirit. Never tells us that. No, no, no. The Lord says, be filled with the Spirit. Because the moment I receive Christ, I'm baptized in his Spirit. For by one Spirit, he has baptized all of those into his body. And it's a continual thing. And it's a struggle for you and for me and for Billy Graham and for Chuck Swindoll and for Charles Stanley and for anybody else that you hold in high regard in Christian circles. It's a struggle. because there's this thing, as we saw in the diagram, this thing called self. You know, self doesn't really like being dethroned. Self likes to call the shots. Self likes to say, well, I want to go where I want to go. I want to do what I want to do. I like to be in control. Lord, I like you to be in my life, but I want you to come alongside and just encourage me and help me, but I still want to control things. Well, that's not how it works. Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 and 17. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. Flesh and the Spirit, they start battling it out. There's a wrestling match inside of you as a believer. And you know what you're wrestling for? You're wrestling for control. Here is a steering wheel. I got this from Olin Owens. He said it came off a BMW. So you know it didn't come from me, or it would have come off a Ford Explorer, but it came off a BMW, came from Olin. And here's a steering wheel. Now, we all recognize that a steering wheel indicates control. I mean, when you're sitting in the car and you have the wheel, no matter what your wife might say to you, and the other, you know, and the back seat driver, the side seat driver, you're in control. You can go where you want to go. Now, when we show the picture of the Lord sitting on the throne or self sitting on the throne, that's just another way of saying the steering wheel. Who's in charge? Who's in control? And here we are, and the Spirit-filled life is you let your hands off the wheel and you let the Lord take the wheel. Lord, you take the wheel. Carrie Underwood, Jesus, take the wheel. That's a song about surrendering your life to Christ. Well, in the Christian life, it's okay, maybe we yield and we say, okay, Jesus, you take the wheel, and we take our hands off the wheel, and the Lord's got the wheel. But then all of a sudden, the Lord, just pretend for a moment that I'm the Holy Spirit, I'm the Lord, and the Lord's got the wheel, and he starts going over here. You're like, hey, what are you doing, Lord? Yeah, we're going over here. I don't want to go over there, Lord. Yeah, shut up. I didn't ask you. You know, who's in charge here? Yeah, but Lord, let's go over here. No, we're not going over there. But Lord, that's where I want to go. And so then what do you start doing? You start grabbing the wheel and from the Holy Spirit, and you start, Lord, let's go over here. No, we're going over here. And there's a battle inside. And the thing about being filled with the Spirit is you have to constantly yield and let go of the wheel, because there's a tendency in you and a tendency in me and a tendency in the Apostle Paul, who wrote the book of Ephesians by the power and inspiration of the Holy Spirit, to grab the wheel, to be in control. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh, for the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit. Flesh wants to go this way. Spirit wants to go this way, sets its desire against the Spirit and the Spirit against the flesh, for these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. You think about sin in your life. You think about how you struggle with sin. When you struggle with sin, it's because you want to do the things that you please. You, well, I want to go to that club. Well, I want to go to that bar. Well, I want to go get drunk. Well, I want to do this. I want to do that. I want to go sleep with this girl. I want. Me. I. Middle letter in the word pride is I. Middle letter in the word sin is I. The Christian life can be summed up this way. Not I, but Christ. Not I, but Christ. And Lord, I submit and I surrender to you, so that you would be in charge of me. And I take my hands off the wheel. And Lord, if you want to go over there, sure seems scary over there, Lord. Sure seems like that's a bad way to go, Lord. But if that's what you want to do, okay, I'll do it. And see, when we come across promises in the Bible and things that God tells us to do in the Bible, a lot of those things don't make sense to us. Giving is one of those things that doesn't make sense to us. You know, where the Lord says in Malachi, hey, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse so that there may be food in my house. And test me thou in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open up for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you a blessing so great that you can't even contain it. And we say, well, Lord, I don't have very much here and you want me to do this, but that doesn't seem right. Who's got the wheel, you or God? When the Lord has the wheel, your only two words are, yes, Lord, you steer, you're in charge, you lead me, you guide me. Holy Spirit, you love me. Jesus, you died for me. God, you have a wonderful plan for me. And so I'm gonna just leave that with you. I used to always pray, God, Lord, I don't wanna be anywhere near the steering wheel of my life. I don't even want to sit in the passenger seat. I just want to get in the back seat. Sometimes I just want to be in the trunk, so I wouldn't even get close to the steering wheel because there's such a tendency to me to jerk it and to want to go this direction, and that messes everything up. And the Lord is not going to, you know, he's a gentleman, and he will fight you, but you can overpower him, so to speak, because of the way God has set it up, and you can say, no, I'm going to do what I want to do. God doesn't make, he doesn't make anybody a robot where you have to do it his way. He wants you to do it his way. The Holy Spirit is constantly convicting and telling us we need to go in this direction. But we fight him. Some of you are in here and you're fighting him. You're fighting him, the God who loves you. You're fighting him. Now you remember, the Holy Spirit is Christ in the Christian. Jesus has nail scars in his hands. You see those hands on the steering wheel, there's nail scars in those hands to tell you that I love you. I died for you. I know what's best for you. Would you please let me lead you? It's hard, the scripture says, to kick against the goads. When the Holy Spirit is telling you, you need to go in this direction, and you say as a Christian, no, I want to go in this direction, you are going to get the sharp stick in the side. You're going to get convicted from God. He's going to come after you. You can overpower that, but it's going to be misery. It's hard to kick against the goats. You know, when you're plowing and the oxen's not going in the direction you want him to go and you keep hitting him with the sharp pointy stick, well, he can go. He can keep going in the wrong direction. But you know what? It's going to be painful for him to do that. And when you and I grab the wheel and say, no, Lord, we're going to go in this direction, it's going to be painful for you to go there. There's a reason why God says, no, don't go there. That place is going to lead you to devastation and ruin and pain, and I don't want that for you. So let me lead you. God wants you to live continually yielded, moment by moment by moment by moment. You let go of the wheel. And when you sin, just know, I grab the wheel again. God, I just want to confess that as sin. Lord, I want you to lead me and control me and guide me. John the Baptist said this, he must increase, but I must decrease. And the more that you and I walk with God, this is what you'll find, is the more that your hands are off the wheel and you're letting the Lord be in control. So first discovery, there are two categories of foolish people. Second discovery, the filled people understand the will of the Lord. And lastly, the filled experience the effects of the Holy Spirit. The effects of the Holy Spirit. Now, look at the first two kinds of fools, the complete fool and the Christian fool, the self-centered life and the self-directed life. Now, they're very, very different in that the self-centered life, the complete fool, Jesus Christ isn't in his life. And the Christian fool, Jesus Christ is in that person's life, but not leading, not in control. So very, very different, but from what you and I can see in terms of how this person lives, the circles look the same. There's discord and there's frustration and there's strife and there are problems because you are in charge. You are driving. Your hands are on the wheel. Even though Christ might be in your life, you're not letting him control you. And so you take a lost guy and you take a carnal Christian, that's what the Bible calls it, carnal, because you're still fleshly, you're still self-motivated and self-driven. You take those two people and you look at them, you can't tell much difference because they're still dominated by the deeds of the flesh, the sins of the flesh. Now, the saved guy might go to church. He might be more religious than the other guy. He might have some more outward things that would say, well, that guy, I guess, is a Christian because he goes to a Bible study class and he reads the Bible some and he does this and that. I see him at church some. But when you really see him during the week, the way he acts, the way he reacts, both those guys are pretty much the same. It's not good. You can't really tell. Okay, because there's no effect of the Holy Spirit in that person's life because they're not letting the Holy Spirit steer. They're not letting the Holy Spirit take control. So when the Holy Spirit comes in, there are changes. When he takes over, there are changes that come. Verse 19, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody with your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to God, even the Father, and be subject to one another in the fear of Christ. And you mark it down. When the Holy Spirit is in control, he changes you from the inside out. From the inside out. Christianity is an inside job. The Lord comes into your life through the person of the Holy Spirit to work himself out of your life so that the sweet aroma of the knowledge of him goes forth in every place that you go. It's an inside job. Religion is an outside job. It's an outside job. It's where you try and clean yourself up to make yourself respectable to God. You'll never be able to do that. Never, ever, ever, ever. Jesus talked about that. He said to the Pharisees, you guys are whitewashed tombs. You look good on the outside, but inside there's dead men's bones and rottenness. People do that and they try and cover themselves up with religion. And say, well, that's what I'm going to present to the Lord. And they know in their heart they're rotten because they've never humbled themselves, opened themselves up to the Lord, and cried out with blind Bartimaeus, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. What's their problem? Pride. P-R-I-D-E. It's all about me. It's all about me. Hey, when the Holy Spirit comes in, one of the things that he does as you yield to him, he changes you. And the scriptures that we read talk about the changes. What does it look like when a person is filled with the Holy Spirit? Well, there's joy. Speaking to one another. The Holy Spirit changes the way you speak. Just like when you're drunk, that changes the way people speak. They start to slur their words. You can tell when somebody's drunk. It's like, what's up with that guy? What's up with that girl? They're talking differently. When the Holy Spirit is in control, all of a sudden, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Now notice, there's nothing mentioned here about speaking in tongues. This is about speaking, is articulating words that people can understand. Psalms aren't written in unknown languages, psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. You're going to speak those things. It changes how you speak, and it gives you joy because all of a sudden now there's a song in your heart, singing. That's a mark of being filled with God's Spirit. There's a song there. Now, you might not be a very good singer. Some people they're not very good at singing. I'm not very good at singing, but I have a song. I have a song. Man, I can let it rip in my car by myself. In the shower, it's just because it's just in there. And I like music. And that's one of the things, a mark of being filled with God's Spirit. You want to sing. You want to make a joyful noise to the Lord. I love what Shelby Holder, a dear member of our church, said. You know, he said, sometimes we sing songs in church, Jeff. And he said, I don't know those songs. And I have trouble catching on to the beat and things. He said, so I just read the words. And I just rejoice in my heart over the words. I was like, wow. You know, that's a guy, he's making melody in his heart to the Lord. That's part of being filled with the Holy Spirit. But what else is a part of being filled with the Holy Spirit? Giving thanks. Verse 20, always giving thanks to the Lord. for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to God, even the Father. Thankfulness and gratitude, that's an evidence that you're filled with the Holy Spirit. You know, when you're filled with self and your hands are on the wheel and you're going in the direction you want to go, there's grumbling, griping, and complaining. When the Holy Spirit is in charge and you're going the direction He wants you to go, there's gratitude and thanksgiving. I talked to a dear lady in our church whose husband died just the other day from a brain tumor. He had it for a year. He was diagnosed on September 11th, 2013, and he passed away on September 11th, 2014. And her heart is crushed. And I said to her, I said, Robbie, I said, you always have to look at this as God gave you your husband for that length of time, almost 10 years. And I said, you can't look at it that you've been cheated. You got to look at it as I didn't deserve one day. It was a gift from God. And that's the way we have to look at all the things that happen to us so that you don't get bitter, so that you can be thankful and say, Lord, I'm hurting, but I praise you for it anyway. That's a mark of being filled with the Holy Spirit and being subject to one another in the fear of Christ. You mark it down. Any person who has to have his own way, her own way, that is evidence that that person is not filled with the Holy Spirit. And when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, not only does it change you, but it changes your relationships with people. Because that goes on to say in Ephesians about marriage. The most important relationship in our lives outside of our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ is marriage. Because marriage is the institution that God ordained, and from marriage comes family and comes procreation. And so marriage is so critical. And we have a world today where people are bailing out on marriage just like that, like it's no big deal. And well, I have quote unquote irreconcilable differences. Let me tell you something. You want to have marriage advice? Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Because if you're walking with God, filled with His Spirit, you're letting the Holy Spirit control you, and she's letting the Holy Spirit control her, you're not going to have irreconcilable differences. The Holy Spirit doesn't fight with the Holy Spirit. So when the Holy Spirit's in control of me, and when the Holy Spirit's in control of Debbie, we're doing great. But when Jeff's in control of Jeff, and Debbie's in control of Debbie, well, we have lots of differences. We're going all over the place, and we're fighting all the way. So, hey, be filled with the Spirit, because that'll enable you, husbands, to love your wife as Christ loved the church. That will enable you, wife, to submit yourself to your husband's loving leadership. He says in your family relationships, hey, children, be obedient to your parents as unto the Lord. How are you going to do that? By the power of the Holy Spirit. Fathers, don't provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. How are you going to do that, dads? By the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will enable you to love your kids and discipline your kids and lead your kids and train up your kids. We need the Holy Spirit for everything. We get the idea that we can do this on our own. We can't. And then it goes on to say in chapter 6 about employer-employee relationships. At work, you need the power of the Holy Spirit so you can be the employee God wants you to be, so you can be the employer God wants you to be. God's Spirit changes everything. And then the Holy Spirit produces wonderful fruit in your life. Wonderful fruit. The fruit of the Spirit, the scripture says in Galatians, is love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and faithfulness and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Now, I want you to look at this slide, and then I'll be finished. Bible talks about the fruit, the deeds of the flesh, and the fruit of the Spirit. The deeds of the flesh, when self is on the throne, the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmities or hatred, strife, jealousy, anger, disputes, dissensions, factions, envying, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these, of which I forewarned you, Paul says, just as I have also forewarned you that those who practice such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God, Galatians chapter 5. But the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, against such things there is no law. Now, I want you to look at those. You honestly assess. See, we're in this, we made a circle, right? That's how we started the sermon. We made a circle. This is just for me. Which one represents, which fruit best represents my life? Am I foolish? Are the deeds of the flesh all around me as I watched the football game last night? Anger, factions, smashing things. That's not on there, but that came to mind, you know? Or am I filled with love, joy, and peace? You know, the fruit of the Spirit, those things, they're all God's things. Did you know you can't get those apart from God? They come from God. You can't buy them in a store. You can't get them in a pill or a bottle. People long for peace. They try and buy peace. They try and buy it on the street. Maybe I can get this drug. Maybe it'll give me peace. Doesn't. It just brings hell on earth. That's what God wants to do in your life. That's what happens when you are filled with the Spirit. That's when the Holy Spirit takes control and takes you. But when you are grabbing the wheel and you're going in the direction you want to go, your life will be filled with immorality and impurity and anger and all those deeds of the flesh. Hey, which one best represents your life? Which one do you want to represent your life? Listen, this is the confidence which we have before him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request which we have asked from him. If you will let go of the steering wheel and say, God, forgive me for being in control of my life. I want you, Lord Jesus, by your Spirit, to control me. If you will pray that prayer and let your hands off the wheel, God will fill you with his Spirit, because that's what he wants to do. Don't be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is.
We've been talking about the Holy Spirit today, about who he is and what he does. And the big question is this: does he live in you? Have you received the gift of the Holy Spirit? You see, the Holy Spirit comes into your life when you turn from your sin and surrender your all to Jesus, the one who died for you and rose again. Maybe you're saying, well, Jeff, I really don't know how to do that. I want to do it, but I don't know how. Well, let me help you. Let me lead you in a simple prayer, and you can ask the Lord to come into your life. Just pray with me. Lord Jesus, I need you. I know that I'm a sinner and I'm lost and I can't save myself. But Jesus, I believe you're God in the flesh. I believe you died on the cross. I believe you rose again from the dead. And Lord, right now I ask you to forgive me of all my sins. Come into my life. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. Holy Spirit, live inside of me. I surrender my all to you, Lord, and I promise to follow you all the days of my life. My friend, if you'll pray that kind of prayer and mean it, the Lord will come in by his Spirit, and your life will never be the same. I would love to hear from you, to know that you're watching, to know that God is using this broadcast to make a difference in your life, to know that you just prayed that prayer with me to receive Christ as Savior and Lord. Please take the time to call that toll-free number, write me, email me, let me know what's going on and how we can pray for you. You really are important to God, and you're important to us, and we're here for you.
From His Heart is the viewer-supported broadcast ministry of Dr. Jeff Shreve, who believes that no matter how badly you've messed up in life, God still loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. You can find out more when you go to fromhisheart.org. Real truth, real.